Hello dear parents, good evening. Yet another very powerful session, and this is what actually every parent is inclined or wishes in his or her parenting. सभी parents का यही एक उद्देश्य और एक इच्छा होती है कि the children they are responsible children raised, they are independent kids raised and they are happy and successful kids. So I have with me a very special guest from Bangalore and she's a conscious parenting coach. So thank you so much, Rose. We call her Rose, I call her. So the topic of the day is how to raise functional kids. So this is something interesting and actually very urgently to be addressed. I have with me two mothers, two parents.
Thank you.
Nidhi.
You.
Welcome Nidhi and Meeta, welcome. So Rosima, over to you. Like, what do you mean by we parents, all of us who are viewing this, who would be seeing the recording, by raising functional kids? So I think there is some technical glitch. So here when we are talking about raising responsible kids, so something which comes in my mind is having confident kids. And how does this come? What I am getting present is, then I will come to you, Meeta, for your part of share. That how do you feel this can be, you know, what is the recipe or what is the right, I should not say strategy, but what is the right approach of raising kids the functional kids. So what I think is, yeah, Rose, are you back? We can't hear you.
Yeah, I am here. Can you hear me?
Oh, now we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Now you are audible.
Okay.
Yes, we can hear you now. Yeah, you can please start.
Do you want me to continue? Okay.
Yeah, we didn't hear anything.
Okay. So the place from where I'm coming is that currently I'm a life coach and I see a lot of adults who are not functional. And a lot of their problems originate in their childhood. And so while functional parents... Can you all hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, there's a crack. Yeah, there is a crack coming in between, but we can hear you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So one of the biggest things I feel parents fail to teach children in their enthusiasm to be good parents is that, you know, you do everything for the child. You feed the child, you pamper the child, you give whatever the child is asking and things like that. And children don't learn how to self-regulate themselves, you know. So one of the things that children need going forward to live a happy child or a happy adult is that they be able to manage themselves. So when they are in an office setting or in a school setting, they should be liked by generally people around them. And that's a skill that parents have to actively teach children. So how can you self-regulate yourself? So every child has these episodes of temper tantrums from time to time. They take things, they throw and these. So they don't know how to manage their emotions. They're not connected to their emotions. So it's good for the parents to have these conversations with the child and say, okay, so you look very upset. What do you think was really upsetting you? Once the episode is over, you know, so that the child can think about what happened, what upset me so much, and what was the emotion that I was experiencing and why was I experiencing. So once the parent gets the child connected to this kind of questioning as to what was it that made me go out of control, you know, children slowly learn to control their situations instead of falling, you know, reacting or just being helpless in these situations. So I think one of the greatest things that a parent has to teach a child is to self-regulate. Now, when you talk about self-regulating, there is an active process of calming down. So how can you help a child calm down, understand the emotions and all that? There is also this very, very important aspect of looking at what is it that upset you about that person. So, understanding where the other people are coming from, what is their perspective, what did you understand when that child said this, and what is it that upset you? So, understanding how to accommodate other people into your life, other children into your life. So this is another important aspect of parenting. I would like to ask Nidhi and Meeta,
So
do you feel this is important?
we'll go to Meeta first. That how do you feel about this?
Yes, as a mother of three adult children, I feel that this thing has to be taken up really very early in life. Right from age 1 or 2, they have to be taught to share, to control their emotions. Sometimes we just allow them to be okay. If the child is crying or throwing a tantrum, the parents are trying to do everything that they possibly can to calm that person down. But later on, what happens is we are not rethinking and reframing about that situation. That situation needs to be addressed, and a certain kind of discipline needs to come back to the child so that the child can think what had happened. Yes, I totally agree with Rose. Brilliant.
So one of the most important aspects of this situation is that the parents themselves handle themselves quite well, So when a child sees a parent who's out of control all the time, shouting, out of control, you are not modeling a behavior that a child can learn or accept. And then, you can't really blame the child for being out of control. So one of the important things is that you model this behavior. Do you think that's important, Nidhi?
Of course, in fact, I was about to say it's not the part which only a child should learn. It's a part even we should learn. We should learn, like we should first learn to self-regulate ourselves, and then we can impart the knowledge. So whatever you will teach today, I'll impose all that things on me first, and then I would like to share practical experience to my kids. I think that's a very good topic we are going to discuss today. That's the thing.
Another thing I want to appreciate you, Nidhi. I see your child, the younger one, Rushil, coming in front of the camera and really, like he being groomed in communication, being groomed in that people connect. So how did you get this idea, and how do you think this is helping him as an individual who is growing, preparing himself for failure and success both? So yeah,
The
please.
basic idea is just behind to just groom up his confidence, which was getting disturbed because of no school days these days. So I just wanted him to get more confident of himself. If you are not going to school, if you are not going to any like if you are not meeting the people, still you can have a world to look at you. So that's my perspective behind that. Ki theek hai, you will mix up with people, you will get communication with people, and you will be like all updated. You'll not lose your 2 years of not going to school. That was my main aim. That's it.
Good, Nidhi. I think you brought up a very, very important part. Two things you mentioned. One is that how can you win or how can you lose? And we all teach our children to win. We don't actively teach our children to lose. You know what happens when you lose? So, and you mentioned self-confidence. I think what you were referring to was self-esteem. We teach our children to play tennis, we teach our children to play music, we teach our children to play dance, but self-esteem is the way the child feels about himself. And that needs to be one of the core things that a parent can teach a child. And that comes when you actively have this very, very important conversation about, yes, Ravi is good at singing, but you are good at dancing. And while you teach your
That's the
child that he is important and he's really good at things, it's also important that it be very balanced, that you are good, but someone else is good at this. But that's okay. You are good at something else. So
right.
that kind of a conversation. And I think this 2 years that parents have got with children, while a lot of Indian parents focus about confidence building, like all our schooling is about building confidence, speaking, communication, this and that, But actually, when a child goes to an actual setting in future, in a college or a group discussion setting or an interview setting, it's not about what the child knows. It's about what the child can bring to the table. What can he actively bring out to be able to engage in a very active conversation? That comes from a state very deep within where the child feels, I can do it. And I think a lot of what we need to do is hug a child, cuddle a child, and say that we love them. Right. So I think that comes from that space. Great.
So here one thing more to be added. Yesterday I had a speaker, Sumit Arora ji from Pune, और उन्होंने ये कहा लाइक हिंदी में द डायलॉग वाज कि कभी बच्चे को ये मत बोलिए कि अरे तुमने ये गलती कर दी या तुम ये गलत हो. यू कैन से कि तुम्हारा ये जवाब जो है ये अलग है, और यू कैन से कि मैं जो सोच रहा हूँ ये मेरा द थिंकिंग विच आई एम पोर्ट्रेइंग और कन्वेइंग इज समथिंग डिफरेंट विच आई वॉन्ट टू शेयर टू यू. सो दिस वॉज अगेन अ वेरी पावरफुल स्टेटमेंट फॉर द पेरेंट्स, सो आई वॉन्ट टू शेयर.
Yeah, actually differentiate the act from the child. So if a child has done something wrong, don't say you are wrong. Instead, I feel what this thing that you did could have been done better. You know, instead of making the child feel that he's a bad child, that one thing that he did was went wrong, you know. And I think we make a big deal of whatever the child does wrong, and we actually fail to notice hundreds of things that the child does right, you know. And that's an opportunity that a lot of our parents miss out on. We don't really actively tell, I'm very happy to see you got your ball back and put it in the sink. You know, those kind of reinforcing where you're actively looking for things where a child is doing right instead of what he's not done right.
Can I put a point over this topic? Because yes. What I do at night, we just sit, like I have two sons, so what we do at night, ki I just ask my kids, ki beta, please tell me, aaj maine kya galti kari hai, ya aaj aapko mujhe kya meri baat achhi lagi hai. Pehle main meri mistakes unke saath share karti hu, and then I think ki this is the way to get them come up deliberately, like voluntarily. Fir wo unhone agar in din bhar mein kuch chupaya bhi hota hai, to they come up with that, ki mama, theek hai, fine, I have done this mistake today. So this is the part I am following, like to
good.
Make
I think
share their mistakes with us,
right? I think more than sharing mistakes or anything, I think it is the opportunity you give a child to have a conversation. Many a times, you know, that opportunity, that space is not given by parents. So you have this ritualistic space that you create in your house where you openly speak, aaj maine ye galti kiya, I feel I could have done this better, you know. That space itself, the child feels heard, the child feels my mother is paying attention to me, I am important in my mother's life. I think that space is more important than actually the conversation that you're having.
Whatever.
So good. Like, I'm very, very happy.
We just need to select a topic just to spend time with kids, and they will come up with their mistakes, with their achievements, with their thought process and all. They'll come up themselves with them. That's the way I am doing that. Fine.
Yeah, I think a lot of new age parents are really looking at doing some good things for children, and I'm very happy about it.
Fine.
So, Rose, any 1, 2, 3 more a daily ritual, some tips for the parents? So,
I think instead of finding faults with children and, you know, trying hard to see that a child is growing well, I think we have to start focusing back on the basics as to look at a child 20 years from now and how can the child be independent, you know, be able to function independently. If the child is first time in a relationship, how can the child thrive in the relationship? What are the things that you are giving to the child today? If the child is 5 years old, what are you giving? What skills are you giving today for the child to become independent and function happily? So I think this is one skill. If a parent, all parents can adapt, I think that's the greatest thing that a child can get.
And here one more acceptance which would really work as a magic is accepting our ordinariness as parents, accepting our child's ordinariness also. So here then there are chances that we can work on not on brilliancy, but on everything being a creative bit or a creative piece which is being done by a unique individual born on the planet. And
I think what you're mentioning is that instead of trying to create a grandiose occasion at home, just be present to what little things are happening in the house, you know, just be present. Maybe a small thing like the child picked up something, kept it on the table. That's a very small thing. It's not being ordinary. It's just being present, you know. So I think that's also
honoring our small word and big word, like each thing. So this practice actually builds our self-esteem. It gives us trust within ourselves and others. So this small practice or whatever you we are promising or saying, you know, honoring that. And another thing which I think you are the right one to like just add on this, like the daily chores are I'm seeing in families that the children are the basic responsibility of, you know, the taking the dishes back or laying the table or doing the daily the house affairs to be managed with the mommy without, you know, a helper. So because everybody doesn't have, so I think this training also would raise real functional kids, because in coming times you have to do everything on your own. You cannot look back to anyone. So what do you say?
More than that, Nahid, I think when a mother tells a child to please pick this up and put it there, I think what the child understands is that my mother trusts me with this job. You know, when you tell your child, "Nahi, bacha, tum mat karo, main karungi," what the child is hearing is that my mother doesn't trust me with this job, you know. So I think it is more important for the child to learn that there are few things my mother trusts me with and I am capable of doing it. Did you understand? So like when a small child, you don't give a glass tumbler, like a porcelain tumbler in the child's hand. Nahi bacha, tum gira dogi, toot jayega. What are you actually telling the child? I don't trust you, right? So if you can give a porcelain tumbler and say, I trust you, you can take care of. Even if the child breaks, it's okay. It's important for the child to know that my mom feels I can do it, right? I think those are the things that we miss out as, especially as Indian parents.
Yeah. Rose, how right.
Meeta, please.
Instead of breaking the trust of the child, which will be a trauma for a lifetime, it is
permanent damage.
Better to lose a porcelain glass. I agree with you completely.
Yeah.
And I believe to raise functional kids is to have a channel of communication where the child trusts you, believes you, and has unconditional love. Yes, whatever you do, wherever you go, whatever your ambitions and aspirations are, we are there for you. And that thing, you know, in the huge planet, yes, there are two people who are behind me, my parents, who will always trust me and always unconditionally love me. That will probably give them a better esteem, as you rightly mentioned, and also the confidence to face the big bad world out there.
So I have one, I welcome Shruti from the audience. She is asking, when we speak about the behavior and every other thing, how food plays a role in the growth of the child? How responsible are we parents in this? Yes.
I think we take a lot of guilt around this when children don't have food. The fact of the matter is, no child dies of hunger when food is there around them. So I think all of us mothers have to understand that children will not die of hunger if there is food on the table. They will eat it when they are hungry. You know, we have been this psyched up about we have to put food into the child's mind. And I want whoever has asked this question to note what I'm saying. You know, every time we are forcing something into a child's life, you know, like a food or something that the child doesn't like, we are not allowing the child to make a decision for himself in his life. Did you understand? What the child is actually learning is that no matter what I feel, no matter how much food I have had, how satisfied I am, my mother is going to push her way through. Today it is a mother, tomorrow it will be someone else. And the child never learns to stand up for himself. I think that was a question that the mother was trying to ask, you know, how important is it to feed the children and all these nutrition? And of course, you have to try and give them a balanced food, naturally home-cooked food, instead of providing all the canned and tinned food, which say fortified with vitamins. All the fortified vitamins also come with preservatives, which and fortified vitamins are all artificial vitamins, which never get absorbed into the body. So I think it's good to just give them home-cooked, good, normal, natural food. Let the child decide what the child wants to eat. But I know there are some extreme kids who will say every day I want to eat burger and this and that, you know. So there might be some bit of modeling that we as parents have to do and allow the child to learn with, I mean, you shouldn't force yourself, but at the same time, give the child good values and good environment from where they can pick up good things. So I think a lot of things go wrong because it's easily available and we order a lot of food and children see that. We are not modeling ourselves.
So Shruti is saying, thank you for that. But I am trying to say that these new age parents fail to even cook for their kids. So here as a practice, we have to first accept that kitchen is really boring, because how much ever a woman actually, the real fact is the acknowledgement is not happening, and it's like a boredom. We have to understand the woman's psyche also. So kitchen is not a very interesting area. So some tips which I follow, like I yesterday shared that sometimes I'm like a surgeon in my kitchen. At times when I am here in India with my maid, like ab ye zira de do, ab ye de do, then the cooking is interesting then. So we have to accept that, see, we are imperfect parents, yes, but how can, you know, this can become a more interesting game? Like, so I have requested my husband. Yes, please.
Yeah, there are two things, Naeed. One is that we take up all cooking responsibilities onto ourselves in India, which is the primary thing. Secondary, maybe the mother is working, you know, and if a mother is working and have to look after and do everything in the house, it is impossible. So I think that's where the Indian families lose the balance, because abroad, the husband equally contributes in the kitchen, you know, and that's something culturally we don't have. So whoever has asked the question, I think it is not easy to change cultural behaviors in the country and within our own homes. But yeah, I think step by step, what we can do as parents to model our behavior such that children pick up the right behaviors, I think that's where it has to start. But I know saying this is very easy and doing is not so easy.
If we have the time, I think what we need to do probably for the food is to make them independent, just give them a little responsibility of creating at least the salad or the soup or something, making the juices or coffee or something. Something needs some small, okay, I'm doing the breakfast, you do the coffee. I'm doing the dinner, you do the salad. So that is something we need to do with children.
Yeah. Okay. Also, maybe anything else in the family.
Yes, everybody having their. See, yesterday the child pediatrician the person said that everybody's rights and responsibilities has to be also discussed. So not that a person who is earning and coming is having a like portrayal of he-man of the house or the more attention seeker. So that was very powerful conversation. If everybody can hear, Nidhi, anything you want to give as a some add-on or some practical practice which you think works for parent? Aapko aisa lagta hai?
Fine. I think all are whosoever are here are must be raising their kids to their best point. So whatever practical knowledge depends, I think it depends from family to family. Like meri family mein, I can cook a very good lavish dinner for my kids because I have maid servants at my home. But somebody might not be able to. So I can't make it a practical tip, in fact. Yeah. But in fact, I can just say, just ask your kids to eat a plate full of salad before any meal and then eat whatever you want. So even if they order for burger or junk food for seven days in a month, I am very sure that on the eighth day, they will say, Mama, I am bugged up of eating burger. I no more want to eat it. I'm happy with my salad. I'm happy with my normal food. So just give them the liberty to eat whatever they want for a week. And I can make you assure, because this is the tact I adopt. I just leave them for a week to eat whatever you want for a week. And on the next week, they are like, Mama, I'm bugged up of all those stuff. Now let's come back to our salad and our juice. That is more healthier. This is what I do. I don't know whether
thank you so much
for other people or not.
No, see, it is all trial, and this is everything, you know, comes as a practice, like some new thing we are discovering and we are practicing, and we have to take on the things which we work for us. And we can involve children in the kitchen also, like you give me this or get me that, let us do this. So when they are involved, like the big children, at least my daughter, she's in 10th standard. So what I do the atta thing and then she makes the chapati. So now she's all trained in doing it. And she was trained from 8th class. So thank you everyone. We have really, the 15-minute session has gone to 24 minutes. It has been a real, real good session. That is why I didn't interrupt. Thank you so much. Any 30 seconds more, Rosma, if you want to end the session with your some message to the audience,
no,
to the parents.
I think like Nidhi said, you know, parenting is a very intuitive process.
children are not same, so you can't have the same thing that you do for every child. Right. Children's temperaments are different, their needs are different, they are different. And so I think it is very important for the mother to be intuitively connected with the child and do what feels right. But at the same time, you yourself have to model the same behavior. You can't expect the child to do something and you do something else, you know. So I think that intuition, and like Nidhi said, everyone's situation is different. So I think you have to see what is best possible in the situation. So I think
Thank you everyone for contributing. This was a wonderful session. Thank you so much.
Thank you.